Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome President Siebold Seminars and Publications, Gene Gable.
Good morning. Thanks. Welcome to day two at Siebold Seminars San Francisco. We're off to a great start yesterday. Had a wonderful day, and we're really excited about today. Here on our keynote stage today, we're going to hear from the two brands that essentially define this industry. We welcome you back here at noon to hear from Adobe. And this morning, we're particularly happy to kick off our expo hearing from Apple. I'm not sure that any of you could have, unless you were living under a rock recently, you might have missed the fact that Apple has a new operating system out. And what I'm excited about today is that I think, you know, the media has been covering a lot of the consumer aspects of OS X, but behind that is a tremendous professional, powerful system that we've been particularly intrigued by because of some of the new features that are available. So I think the professional community is going to be really anxious to hear today about Apple's plans moving forward and the sort of state of the art at Apple, because again, it really defines where we are in the industry. So I know you'll help welcome from Apple Computer, Phil Schiller.
Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for joining us here in San Francisco at Siebold. I hope that you find this hour to be really valuable and informative to everyone in the print and publishing and design markets, because that's what we're going to focus on. And in preparation for this, I asked a few of my friends, some really smart people in this industry, and what would they like to hear from Apple, and what should we talk to the Siebold crowd about? And to a person, they said, let's just talk about print and publishing. Let's talk about that market. Let's talk about what you're doing for that market. There's so many things we can talk about cross-media, about video and audio and other things that are so great for creative customers, but we have other shows for that. We can go to NAB. We can go to IBC. Let's talk print and publishing and design. So I'm going to try to tailor what we talk today specifically to that, and I hope you all agree that's really great advice. So that's my focus this morning on Mac OS X and particularly some of the things that make it great and what we're doing for those markets. Now, we're very proud of the role we've had to play in helping these creative markets deliver some amazing stuff to the world. And so every time we get to watch a video or listen to some audio or turn the page of a great publication, I don't know about you, but we're often so happy to think this was made on a Mac. And more often than not, that's true. So for example, the next time you turn a page of The New Yorker, maybe you'll do the same thing. You'll think, cool, made on a Mac. Right? The next time you're reading about some new movie hit that's out in Entertainment Weekly, you'll think, cool, made on a Mac. And maybe the next time you go out and get a Day in the Life book, there's a new one coming out called A Day in the Life of Africa. Beautiful new book. And of course, when you flip the page, you'll think, cool, made on a Mac. Maybe you'll be in Europe, traveling, perhaps Paris, walking down the Champs-Élysées, and you pull out a euro, and you'll think, cool, designed on a Mac. So much great content today is being made on a Mac by all of you, and the next time you see one of these things, maybe you feel like we do, really proud that this platform that we all love has had a role in helping to contribute to the creation of incredible design and publishing. And it's companies like Apple and Adobe and Aldis and so many more that help create the tools that we all rely on today. And we continue to move forward with those tools. This is the state-of-the-art workstation today in the publishing market and print market. It's the new Power Mac G4 with 1.25 gigahertz dual G4 chips. And I have it shown up here with two Cinema HD flat panel displays hooked up to create one massive workspace. And each one of those is 23 inches of thin film transistor love, right? They're so great to work in a workspace like that. It's all color managed with color sync, incredible angle of view, twice as bright, twice as sharp as CRTs. It's really the new state-of-the-art workstation to create all your work on. But maybe, like me, you're somebody who likes to travel when they create, like to be on a plane, under a tree, by the ocean. And you can take all that work with you because, of course, the Titanium PowerBook has been designed for our professional customers with the G4 chip in every one, with 15-inch high-resolution widescreen display. It's really a great product for our creative customers. And, of course, when you go back to the desk now, you can plug it into one of those new cinema displays because of the digital interface that you can add to now hook up incredible, beautiful desktop setup. So just, we're working really hard to make the best products for you to design all your content on and to deliver and produce that content. And really no one else thinks about that anymore. The market's had its ups and downs. It's a tough market in the advertising world and design world, but we haven't stopped. We haven't stopped for one second caring about this market, thinking about those customers as we design these products. So for example, when you bring that great work back to the office, where do you put it? Well, now you have an amazing place to put it. These new X servers, these affordable 1U rack servers. And here's a rack. You can get up to 64 in a rack now, a 64U rack. That gives you 128 G4 processors and a massive amount of storage, yet it's affordable. And it's so easy to set up and manage with Mac OS X that you don't need an army of consultants to help you set it up. You can just do it yourself. And it gives you everything you need for file services and print services and email and web services. Unlike other companies, there's a lot of add-on charges later. We just include it all and make it easy to manage. We're not going to talk about hardware today. I really want to talk about the OS, the platform, about Mac OS X, the latest version, 10.2 Jaguar, and what are we doing in Jaguar, particularly for the print and publishing and design customers, to make it a great new platform for the next generation of your design work. We've worked very hard on this. There are many features you might not have heard at other trade shows and events designed for you. We're going to uncover a bunch of those today. Before we do, this is part of our transition, our path on the way of moving forward to an entirely new operating system base for all of our customers. We set a goal for ourselves that by the end of this year, we'll have just over 20% of our active install base running Mac OS X. That's over 5 million customers. And that will be the fastest OS transition ever in this industry, to be able to move so quickly such a 20% install base of your customers. And we've worked very hard to deliver the technologies and products to make that possible for all of us. So how are we doing? Well, here we are between the July and October quarters, and we're right at the midpoint, around 3 million active users now on Mac OS X. So we're really proud that we're continuing along this path and really achieving our goals. What about on the application front? Well, we have a goal of trying to break through 5,000 applications by the end of the year, and that's going really well as well. Here we are, right between July and October, with just about 3,900 applications now native on Mac OS X and brought onto Mac OS X. You can check them yourself. We have a Made for Mac webpage you can go to through our Apple.com site and count all those if you want yourself. You can do a search and find all these great applications, whatever you need for your particular solutions, and they're all there. And this does not count Java applications, the Unix applications you can bring over, many more thousands of applications that also run on Mac OS X. These are things that are specific native Mac OS X applications. And at this point, I want to thank some of our developers. They've worked so hard to deliver great applications for Mac OS X. Applications that are not only native for Mac OS X, but better than the versions that existed before on 9, and we think better also on Windows. Developers like, of course, Adobe brought over so many great applications. Photoshop and Acrobat and Illustrator and InDesign. And companies like Macromedia with their MX product lines with things like Dreamweaver and Flash. Companies like, of course, FileMaker that so many of you use. And Microsoft with Office. We think the best version of Office runs now on Mac OS X. So many great applications. That, of course, leaves a couple few, so we call them stragglers, that are working hard. And we're working with those companies to get their software out on Mac OS X. But don't forget that part of Mac OS X is a little technology we call Classic. And with Classic, you can run most all your Mac OS 9 apps right under Mac OS X. We also work hard to make that great. And in this latest version of Mac OS X Jaguar, it's faster, it boots up faster, it runs faster, it's even more compatible with everything you use. So you should really try all that old 9 software out in Classic if you need it as well. So Mac OS X Jaguar, the latest release, it's been out just a few weeks now, and it's already set records for us in how well it's doing. It did over 100,000 in its first weekend around the world, so it's being very well received. In fact, if you read some of the reviews out in the press, you'll just see how popular Jaguar is. Here is a great quote from Walt Mossberg, the well-renowned critic and technology reporter of the Wall Street Journal, and Walt wrote, "Jaguar is a big step forward for the Mac and continues the effort to differentiate Apple's operating system from Windows XP." Thanks, Walt. I mean, that's exactly the idea. We're working so hard to once again make the Mac different and better than the PC. We've put so many new technologies in here to enable that and to create new applications that not only are first on the Mac, but run only on the Mac with capabilities that don't exist in the PC world. Here's another example from David Pogue, the New York Times, another great writer. He wrote, if you're among the 23 million Mac fans who've been watching the skies for a sign that it's safe to upgrade to 10, version 10.2 is it. I think it's a very, very true statement for all of you here at Siebold and all of our customers around the world. And we're now moving so that in 2003, as we start January 2003, all of our new systems will only boot to Mac OS X, and of course we'll keep the classic technology, but it's part of our step on the path to move from 9 to 10 and get on with this great new technology. Now why are we getting these great reviews? Well, Jaguar is a major release. There's over 150 new features. It's not just a dot update, it's a major upgrade with so many new features. In fact, this is more features we had than we went from 8 to 9. Such a major upgrade. Now, if we were at a trade show like a Macworld or another more cross-horizontal trade show, we'd talk about a lot of the features that we would all benefit from, but we're not going to talk about those today. So today, we're not going to spend time on the great new mail application that comes in it that has inline PDF viewing and a junk mail feature. We're not going to talk about iChat, which you can use to create instant messaging workflows and drag and drop documents to send to people easier than you ever could do with file sharing. We're not going to talk about the address book that creates a system-wide database for all your contacts and people. We're not going to talk about Sherlock 3, which is the coolest way to find information on the Internet. And with Sherlock 3, you can search, for example, for images using the Getty Image database. We're not going to talk about iCal, which is a really cool first new calendar system built for the Internet age, which is available today. If you're a Jaguar user, you can today go and download the new free iCal software. And we're not going to talk about universal access, which makes it easy for all of our customers to get the most out of their Mac experience. And we're not going to talk about the Finder. And the Finder is this incredibly new, powerful version of the Finder. It's faster. It includes a built-in search field so you can find whatever you want quickly. We're not going to talk about the new Unix features. This is the latest, best version of a BSD Unix available on any platform. And last but not least, we won't have time today to talk about the great Windows integration features. This is getting some of the strongest reviews and comments from people in the press. The ability built into Mac OS X to share files with Windows machines, to connect to Windows servers, to share printers, to connect to Windows printers, and integrate Macs and Windows in the networks. So we don't have time for any of that today, because we're going to talk about things that are even more directly relevant to our print and design and publishing customers. So today we are going to talk about Quartz Extreme. We're going to talk about QuickTime 6 and Inkwell. And we'll talk about image capture in ColorSync and AppleScript. We'll talk about fonts. When's the last time you've been to an event and people talked about fonts? Yeah, people care about fonts. Right? We're going to talk about rendezvous and what does that mean to all of us in our print design world. So we're going to talk about printing, good old printing, because it's so important to things that all of you do today. So those are the things we're going to talk about Mac OS X and Jaguar. So let's get started. Quartz Extreme. It's this powerful new technology that comes in Jaguar. And it's the latest version of our Quartz imaging system. Now, you remember the days when the Mac had this great imaging system and it could do fonts and graphics and page layout, and those poor little PCs couldn't do any of that. Right? They were stuck in their single application world and they did not have the capability to create rich documents and share these with others and print out the gorgeous quality fonts. Well, we have now created a new imaging system that is, again, years ahead of what the PC platform has to offer, and we call that Quartz. And Quartz comes from an idea actually written in a paper at SIGGRAPH years ago by some PhDs from Pixar that talked about the future of a computing system that had the ability to composite different media types together onto one platform, 2D and 3D and video, seamlessly. Well, that's what we've done with Mac OS X and Quartz, never before in a computer system. So built into the core of the operating system is compositing, the ability to blend between those different media types and create shadows and transparency. If you look at it from a system block diagram, and this is probably the most techie thing we'll do today, so I promise not to spend too much time on it, but there you see right above the BSD open source kernel of Mac OS X, right above Darwin, is the graphics layer with Quartz and OpenGL and QuickTime. And in fact, if you step a little bit further into it, you find there's a technology that's really cool that combines those together, that binds these three different media types, 2D and 3D media. It's like our one ring for QuickTime. Right? The one ring is the quartz compositor, and it combines all this stuff together and allows it to be blended into one seamless user experience for all of us so that we can have a better user experience and developers can create unique applications that have capabilities that could not be done on your PCs. And it's a beautiful working environment. You see video that can interact with transparency of other applications. You see windows that do drop shadows onto PDF documents. You see 3D applications that can have transparency with a Unix terminal window. These things can all interact seamlessly as they should in one computing environment so that you can do things that were not possible in a personal computer. And that's what Quartz brings. And what's new in the Jaguar version of 10.2, what's new is what's called Quartz Extreme. The ability to take this compositing environment and rather than have your G4 or G3 chip do all the work to composite the graphics, our engineers came up with a really amazing idea. They take all that compositing work and they put it on to these new high-speed graphic cards from ATI and NVIDIA and have OpenGL do all that compositing work so the G4 can be free to do other things. And it means you get faster graphics and more compute cycles for all the other things your computer's doing. Faster computing and faster graphics both. Just an ingenious idea. So how does that work in real-world performance? This is some benchmarks we use internally at Apple to see how we're doing with Quartz performance. And in these bars, bigger is better, right? Bigger is faster. Because what we're measuring is operations per second. The more you can do, the faster your setup. So what you see in the blue bar is 10.1 doing scrolling and moving windows and resizing. And then next to it, the magenta bar, 10.2, just running on the G4 chip and, of course, getting much faster. So without a latest graphics card, you get faster speed-ups. And scrolling is something that we can right away make faster on the processor. But the scrolling isn't interacting with other windows. It's not doing that compositing stuff. If you start to do moving of windows and resizing of windows, now you're using a lot more of the Quartz compositing engine. And by putting it onto those graphic chips, you see some really big speed-ups. So that third bar is 10.2 now with a graphics card in the system that can run Quartz Extreme, automatically take advantage of all that power, and you see for things like moving windows and resizing, dramatic speed-ups. So now with Jaguar, we have all this Quartz compositing power, and we get faster performance, and it's all at the benefit of seamless, beautiful user experience. So I'd like to invite Chris Borden, Product Marketing Manager for Mac OS X on stage, to demonstrate Quartz and Quartz Extreme.
All right, thanks, Phil. Good morning, everyone. Thank you. So let's take a look at this Quartz Extreme thing that Phil's talking about and the first ever fully composited Windows system in Mac OS X. As design professionals and content creators, I'm sure you're all very familiar with QuickTime, so I'm going to get a QuickTime movie up and running. This is actually an MPEG-4 QuickTime movie, which is now newly supported in Jaguar with QuickTime 6. And I'm just going to get this playing and let us enjoy this beautiful, beautiful show for our video. So this video is very high resolution, as you can see. It's a full 24 frame per second video. It runs more than 3.2 megabit per second data rate, so it's really, really high quality, high bandwidth stuff. So let me show you a brief example. What does compositing mean exactly? What the compositor does is it actually treats every window and every menu in the system as a layer, and then it composites them together in real time. So as you can see here, I've got a drop-down menu which is semi-transparent. And it's actually compositing that in real time over the moving video. See, we're not really dropping any frames, full 24 frame per second video as I'm compositing through that semi-transparent menu. That's an example of compositing. Now, what I want to do to show the performance off here is get a couple of performance tools up here so you can see how Quartz Extreme affects our computer. We've got a CPU monitor right here. And the CPU monitor is going to tell me how hard each of my processors is working. We've got two processors in this machine, so we're going to have two CPU monitors. And the other tool I have is this special Quartz Extreme demo tool. And what we've done is this thing does two things. The first thing it does is it's got this great analog speedometer here. And what this speedometer is going to show me is how many times per second the compositor is recompositing. To get really fluid, nice motion graphics, you want to recomposite as many times per second as possible. And this meter is going to show us how many times per second the compositor is recompositing the desktop. Obviously, higher is better. The faster, the more fluid the performance is going to appear. The other thing this lets me do is actually turn Quartz Extreme on and off. By disabling it right here with this button, this nice big disabled word, I'm going to start with the compositor working on the CPU. So in software, just as it was before we shipped Jaguar. When I enable it, it's going to move the compositor from the CPU to the GPU, and that's when Quartz Extreme is going to kick in. So we're going to start off in disabled mode to give you a context of where we are today. I'm going to bring up a terminal window. For those of you who may have not heard, Mac OS X is founded on Unix. It's Unix-based underneath. For those of you who enjoy the terminal, you can get right at it. Let me give you another example here of, let me get my movie playing again, kind of so you can see something moving on screen. Another example of compositing right here in the terminal is I can actually make this semi-transparent. I'm just going to dial some transparency in there. And you can see, again, I'm compositing a semi-transparent window now over the video again. Now, just take a second and realize what's going on here. This is something that has never existed on the desktop operating system before. Being able to composite in real time layers together on desktop is amazing. And this is the power of Quartz. Now, let's kick this thing and make Quartz work a little bit. You can see that our CPU is working pretty hard now because while it's playing the video, it's also doing all the compositing. So our CPU is at about 70-75% max load, and you can see that we're compositing at about 30-35 frames per second. That's how many times, again, that the compositor is redrawing and recompositing the screen. So let's really put Quartz through its paces. I'm just going to do a standard window move. And again, to create really fluid graphics, the compositor needs to composite as fast as possible, and you can see that with all the compositing on the CPU, that our CPU load is quite heavy, nearly 100%, that our video is dropping a lot of frames, and it's not very smooth anymore, that our window move is a bit jagged and a bit uneven. And you can see that the compositor is really only operating at about 8 frames per second. And this is with all the Quartz compositing being done on the CPU. And I'm going to make one significant change. I'm simply going to enable the Quartz Extreme, and watch the difference. The windows move very fluid, very smoothly. The video plays full 24 frames per second again. You notice that our CPU monitor, whereas before it was pegged trying to handle both the compositing and the decoding of the video in real time, it's now dropped off to about 35% of total CPU load. And you can see that our compositor itself has gone from 10 frames per second to upwards of 115 frames per second. Once again, how many times per second I'm recompositing the desktop? In fact, I've freed up so much CPU by offloading this, I can bring up another movie. I'm going to get that one playing. Another high frame rate video. This movie is actually 30 frames per second. It's running at more than 4 megabits per second of data. And once again, I'm going to move my semi-transparent window around. You can see, once again, more than 160 frames per second of compositing by offloading this onto the GPU. So that's Quartz Extreme in action. The amazing ability to composite in real time 2D, 3D, and multimedia graphics by using the powerful graphics processor in our great Power Macs. Bill?
So Quartz Extreme gives us tremendous performance and capabilities. There's one other element of the Quartz environment I want to make sure we talked about today, particularly at Siebel with this audience, and that's PDF. Many of you who use Mac OS X today already know that the Quartz imaging environment natively uses PDF all the time with everything you're doing. You don't have to go into some special mode, add some special software. It just works. So anything you can see on your screen, if you can print it, it's already a PDF file before you even click print. And so we've worked very hard to make PDF completely built into Mac OS X as it never has been before. And we're really pleased with the work we've been able to do with Adobe. I mean, this really is part of their vision that they've been delivering to the world of creating a better workflow using PDF documents that we can all count on. And in Mac OS X, when you save a PDF in any application, it automatically embeds the color sync profile. It automatically embeds the font glyphs you need. So you can send that to anyone on any platform, and it just works. It's based on standards. And yet you have the easiest platform for doing this. You can create it from anything. You can view it at any time. And in Jaguar, PDF has moved forward to use the latest standards. It's based on 1.3, and it adds extensions from the new 1.4 spec. For example, extensions for support of complete transparency from application all the way through to printer. Support for secure documents. And this is one of the most powerful, simple workflow things we can do today. anything that's on your Mac screen that you can print, you can save as a PDF, you can use a tool like Acrobat or InDesign and add security information and passwords, and now send it to any customer in the world, any work partner in the world, and only they can open it with the passwords. Such an important thing to add to our workflow. And of course, we've made this really fast, so PDF is now accelerated for our symmetric multiprocessing on these dual processor Power Macs and accelerated for the G4's Velocity engine. And we've made it even easier to make PDFs inside the print window of every application that uses Apple's print, standard print dialog box. There's now a Save as PDF button to make it even one step simpler to do. And we've enhanced the Preview app. That's the built-in application that comes with Mac OS X that allows you to view just about any graphic format and, of course, also view PDFs. And it supports all these new features as well. Chris?
Great. Thanks, Phil. So let's take a look at a couple of these new PDF features. I've got a great application here on my desktop called OmniGraffle. It's an application we actually ship with our Power Macs. This is a great diagramming tool, and I'm going to use it to mock up a new a concert poster. So I'm going to come in here and just create some rectangles. Draw that real quick. And I'm going to take the shadow off and take the line outline. I'm going to add some color to this, and I've got one preset here, a nice semi-transparent red. And I want to add some text as well. And I've got some favorites here, preset. Got Futura, which is one of my favorites. And I'm going to name my band here, the Vibes. And I'm going to make some of this text semi-transparent. So I'm going to dial that down, give it a certain level of transparency, and add one more block here at the bottom. Do the same thing. I'm going to take the shadow off, take the line off, add some color to this as well. Nice purple. And add a little bit of text. And this great band is playing locally here. Highlight that, and once again, I want to make this also semi-transparent. So now I've got this great document, got some semi-transparent content to it, and one of the great things, of course, about our built-in PDF support is the ability to create PDF from any application in Mac OS X. And as Phil mentioned, we've got a great new Save as PDF button right in the print panel. So I'm just going to save as PDF and name my document, save that to the desktop. And the entire imaging system in Mac OS X is based on PDF, so I've just simply printed a file out using the built-in PDF capability. I'm going to quit out of this. And you'll notice also the built-in support for transparency. So I've created this document in OmniGraffle, and I've saved it out as PDF, and I've opened it in our standard Preview application. And because Preview uses our built-in PDF support, it also retains the transparency, just as you'd expect. Now, our goal with PDF is we've put PDF in at the core of Quartz. It is part of, and it is the foundation of our imaging model in Mac OS X. And our goal with PDF is, of course, we want to enable PDF across the entire system throughout the applications that we ship and through the applications that our vendors ship. But PDF is a standard and a specification. We want to create documents that work across all platforms. This is the same document that I just created. I'm going to drag and drop it onto Acrobat. Standard Acrobat 5. Resize it. And you can see the same transparency, the same resolution, the same exact document created using the Mac OS X PDF system is viewable in standard Acrobat. And one of the other features that Phil talked about was document security. And built into Acrobat, I can actually assign passwords to access this particular document. So I'm going to go in here to the document security, choose the standard security model, and I can add a password here that will control opening the document, and I can also assign a password for changing permissions and passwords on the document, have an administrator-level password, if you will. I'm going to change the encryption level to the latest and greatest that Acrobat uses. I'm actually going to disallow content copying and extraction. I don't want anybody who gets this document to be able to take any of the text out of it and copy it anywhere else. And I'm also going to not allow anybody to change it. Really, what I want to do is create a document that people can, that is secure, but is really only consumable. And I'm going to hit OK. And it's going to ask me to verify my passwords that I've typed, and I'm going to do that. Now I'm simply going to save my document, save over the previous version of our document. And once again, I'm going to double-click this. And again, because we have full security support in Quartz's PDF model, you'll see that it automatically comes up and asks me for my password. So I'm going to type in the basic password. And you can see it shows me exactly what I'm able to do. I'm able to view. I'm able to print. And once again, the same exact document with all its full transparency, nice high resolution is available. So that's PDF, and that's some of the new changes that we've made in the Quartz and the PDF imaging model. Phil?
Thanks, Chris. So we've created with macOS 10 again an imaging system that is second to none in the industry and is really setting the direction that others will follow. And again, the Mac now is years ahead of giving the core technologies that all these great new apps are going to be built on top of, and yet have features that we can all use immediately today, like those PDF features that Chris just showed. Next up, QuickTime 6. Again, this isn't NAB, so we won't go into great depth about the video features and capabilities of QuickTime 6, but maybe there's a feature or two you haven't seen yet or didn't know about that I just want to talk to this audience about. Well, first of all, the most important thing everyone needs to know about QuickTime 6 is it is the first media architecture built completely on open standards, and no one else has done that yet. I mean, isn't it time to throw away the arguments over whose player plays what content? I mean, when I buy a TV set, I don't have to pick which TV set I want because of what channel I want to watch. That's not how it should work in this industry either. So the latest version of QuickTime, QuickTime 6, that's built into macOS 10, has MPEG-4 at its core as its new audio and video codec. And this is the latest video codec, incredible quality and open standards based. It's good for your stored media as well as what's streamed over the internet. It also has the latest audio codec. Now, a lot of you I know love encoding and ripping your music and having it on your systems. AAC is the new codec specified in the MPEG-4 spec, and it's from Dolby Labs. And it's better than WMA, it's better than MP3, which came from MPEG-1. AAC is the great new audio codec, and it's built into QuickTime 6, built into macOS 10. It also has in the player now instant on streaming. So when you go to watch something on the web, you don't have to wait for pre-buffering to happen, it just starts playing instantly. Of course, QuickTime comes matched with a QuickTime streaming server to deliver this content, and that's free to the world. Apple makes our QuickTime streaming server free. It comes with macOS 10 server, and it's also part of our open source project, the Darwin streaming server, and that's been brought to many other platforms, Linux and Windows, and it's even included in other people's server products, products from companies like Sun and IBM. And there's a new product now that you may not have heard of called the QuickTime Broadcaster. Another free piece of software from Apple that makes it easy for you to create your own live broadcast on the internet now and then store the content later for on-demand video viewing too. And it's all based on MPEG-4. So you have the first end-to-end open standards-based high-quality streaming environment with the server, the broadcaster, and the client all working together. And the quality is just incredible. Just beautiful video and audio, the latest generation codecs written by Apple and available to you. But probably a feature you may not have noticed in QuickTime 6 that's very important to this market is a new graphics format. On the Mac version of QuickTime, it comes on macOS 10, we have a new codec called JPEG 2000. I'm sure many of you have heard it. It's an industry standard codec created by the ISO and IEC, and it uses the latest compression technology, wavelet compression. It's very powerful, and it's designed to give you a choice between lossless compression or lossy compression. So it's very powerful, some tremendous technology, and it just works in macOS 10. I can, from within my applications, I can just drag a picture to preview and say save as JPEG 2000. And anything that supports QuickTime can save to JPEG 2000. Anything that opens up content and uses the QuickTime codecs can open up JPEG 2000s. So it just automatically works. So if you're using Jaguar, I urge you to check out the new JPEG 2000 codec. We worked very hard to deliver a great new graphics codec that works across all your software. So that's QuickTime 6. Inkwell. In macOS 10, with Jaguar, we've delivered handwriting recognition technology. This is the technology that came from the new Newton, which is still the best handwriting recognition today. And we've done it in a totally new way. We asked the team to do something that no one has done before, which is what if you built handwriting recognition right into the core text engine of your operating system? What could you do? And that's what we've delivered with Inkwell. And one of the design centers for it was all of our customers in the creative markets who have those tablets, the Wacom tablets and others like that, that you can write on and draw on, but you didn't have handwriting recognition for, and it works directly with those. And it's, again, because it's integrated into the text system, it means it works with all your software. You don't have to create some special ink mode and translate it later. You just start writing, and it works in all your software. And no training of that software. It just starts recognizing your handwriting. So, for example, here's a screenshot of Adobe Photoshop. Like all software, it uses the text engine inside macOS 10. And this is the typical example of a customer who might want to use this. You're sitting at your desk. you're working in an image in Photoshop, you're using your pen tablet, and when you want to go and add some text, you double-click on that text with the pen, and you don't have to go over to the keyboard, you just start writing. And magically on the screen, a semi-transparent yellow sheet shows your handwriting as you're writing on the tablet. That's thanks, of course, to that great quartz technology. You see now it being used in other ways. And instantly, as you write, it will translate that and put it right into your Photoshop document. And this, again, works with all your software. It works with Word. It works with Excel. It works with Mail. It works with Photoshop. It works with InDesign. You can just, wherever you are, if you have a pen tablet, just start writing. So that's one of the new features built into Mac OS X Jaguar. Image capture. Getting images into the computer is one of the most important things we do all the time in the design and creative markets. And image capture is our technology for acquiring images. And built in, this architecture supports hundreds of USB and FireWire devices. In fact, with Jaguar, we've added more. In particular, we paid attention to some of the new pro devices, the new pro cameras from companies like Canon and Nikon to make sure those worked extremely well. One of the biggest comments we got from our customers in the pro markets is you have to start building an architecture for scanning into 10. It was an add-on in 9, and we need to build that into 10. And we've done that with Jaguar. There's now scanners built into image capture out of the box it supports. There's new devices being added every single day to image capture via the web. And we've built in a framework for Twain, which, as you know, is the industry standard interface for scanners. And now scanner companies can write standard Twain drivers, drop them into your Mac OS X system, and image capture just automatically works with them. And of course, since ColorSync is completely integrated into the system, it improperly embeds ColorSync photos, profiles as well. Now, image capture, the application, has changed so much you may not recognize it. Here's that image capture application supporting a scanner. You plug in a scanner, and it works, and it is a scanning application. Other applications can use it as an engine, but it also itself directly supports scanners. Now you plug in a digital camera, and it magically morphs into an application that now supports that digital camera, because it's all about image acquisition. Cameras, scanners, just all work inside that image capture architecture, and you can get more plugins, more drivers for more and more devices, and you'll continue to add support to this. And it now gives a one focus place for us to work with all our developers to give you the best scanning and digital camera support on the market. And this is the same engine that iPhoto uses. Under the hood, iPhoto uses the image capture engine to connect to and get images from digital cameras. I'd like to ask Chris to come back and give us a demo of image capture.
Thanks, Bill. So with Mac OS X and the Macintosh, we have an incredible array of built-in support for all sorts of digital devices like digital cameras and digital camcorders. We have great built-in applications that let you take advantage of these devices like iMovie and iPhoto, and of course, with the new iMacs and the Power Macs, we have SuperDrive, which allows you to create your own DVDs. A lot of us think of all this built-in support as enabling the consumer digital hub. That is great for taking pictures of the kids and sending to mom and dad. But this digital hub also supports the professional user. I've got right here, I think, the camera of choice for today's photojournalists. This is a Nikon D1X. It actually takes standard Nikon lenses, interchangeable lenses. It takes very high resolution, 5-megapixel pictures. And one of the most interesting things about it is because it takes such high-resolution images, and you can certainly get a lot of them on today's compact flash cards, rather than having USB on it, right here in the back it actually has a FireWire port. Because FireWire, of course, is going to give us the highest speed. Mac OS X, much like these consumer devices, has built-in support for this device as well, for this Pro camera. So I'm simply going to come over here, grab my FireWire cable, plug it in, and simply turn on my camera. And as Phil talked about, image capture is a system-wide architecture for acquiring images from devices like cameras and scanners, and iPhoto uses image capture. So I'm actually going to start here in iPhoto. You can see that iPhoto is automatically launched when I plugged in my camera, and it's automatically recognized my camera. You see here in the lower left-hand corner the Nikon D1X. I'm going to get this importing and get these pictures off the camera. Again, this is a very high-speed interface, FireWire. Each of these pictures, 5 megapixels. We're moving a lot of data through here very quickly into iPhoto. These 12 high-resolution pictures downloading in about 10 to 15 seconds, all through the power of FireWire. And of course, they download and they automatically add to my library. And of course, you're very familiar with some of the features of iPhoto. For example, I want to come in here and say, rotate some of these images. Very simple to do right there, right here, right on the machine. Of course, I want to be able to resize and see my entire portfolio of my entire library of images and resize them and make them larger as well. And of course, I can also organize by film rolls. These are basically import sessions, if you will. And I can scroll through here and see each specific import session. Here's one we just did at the top. So these are a lot of features that I'm sure you're very familiar with as users of iPhoto. Now, some of the features that you may not be aware of that are a bit more tailored for the pro user, I'm going to come in here into preferences. We've got a lot of feedback from users that, yeah, they like the white background for the light box. You can think of iPhoto as a digital light box. But they wanted some control over that. So I can click on frame, and I actually can change the background any shade between white and complete black. So any shade that I want in between there, I can make that black. Another great feature here, these cameras, when they take the picture, they actually write metadata with these pictures. This is called EXIF data. And iPhoto, just through the Get Infill panel, will actually show me that metadata, that EXIF data that's related to that picture. This shows how wide and how high this picture is, what the resolution is. It tells me when it was taken. It tells me how big it is on disk. And one of the coolest things is it actually tells me all the exposure information. What was the shutter speed? What was the aperture set at? This is definitely information that pro users are interested in. Another feature that Phil talked about is JPEG 2000 support. Because iPhoto uses our standard QuickTime image converters, and because QuickTime has got built-in support for JPEG 2000, as does the whole system, I can simply take a picture here that I've exported as JPEG 2000, simply drag and drop it into my iPhoto library. And just like I downloaded images off my camera, it automatically is going to add that picture to my library. And now I've got great JPEG 2000 image right here in iPhoto. Now, one other thing, we talk a lot about the ability to share these pictures with our friends and family. One of the ways I can do that is using these great books. And it's great to be able to send mom and dad pictures of the kids in one of these nice bound books. But this is also a tool that you can use to create your portfolio and send it to clients and customers if you're a pro photographer. So I'm simply going to click on the book setting, and I can preview this. And actually, what iPhoto does is use the built-in PDF capabilities of the system to actually create a PDF of our book. And I can preview it right here. And of course, in the end result is I've got this beautiful book, nice full linen bound. It has nice, high-quality, acid-free paper. And I'm going to turn to one of the last pictures in this because I think it's really great. And you can also notice that it has full edge-to-edge printing, full bleed printing. And it's a very nice style, very portfolio-like. I feel very professional sending this to customers and clients. So not only for sending pictures to mom and dad, but for also sending your portfolio as well. Now, like Phil mentioned, we actually have an image capture application as well. So I'm going to get my camera back out here so it sees it. My photo pop back up. So there we go. This is our image capture application. And like Phil said, image capture is an architecture. It is responsible for handling all the image acquisition in the system. And with the image capture application, you can see that it also recognizes my camera. I can click on download some here. It actually shows me all the pictures that are on my camera. And there are a number of advanced options here that I can get at through the image capture application that I might want to set. For example, I may want to assign a specific color sync profile to every photo that comes off this camera. And so I can simply change the profile. I'm going to change it to Adobe RGB. And now whenever I plug this camera in, it's going to automatically embed this particular profile in every image off this camera. And because iPhoto uses the image capture architecture, this also works in iPhoto. And it will work in any other application that uses the image capture architecture. So this is really a system-wide setting, if you will. I can also get it to automatically set the camera's date and time. Got some nice view options here, which let me make the icons bigger and smaller. Nice, cool, nice stuff. And just like in iPhoto, I can actually come in here and highlight some of these pictures. And I can actually rotate them while they're still on the camera. I actually haven't downloaded these pictures yet, so I'm rotating them. So when they do download, they'll be fully rotated. I've got another view here, a list view. Again, another opportunity. I can see each picture on the card. And again, once again, the EXIF data. How high? What's the width and resolution of the picture? How many DPI? What's the bit depth? What's the exposure? So all that's available right here in the file in the list view as well. One other great feature of this is automation. Image capture has automation built into it as well. And without actually taking the shutter, Phil will come over here and I'll use him as my guinea pig. You notice I've got this cool little take picture icon in the toolbar. So I'm just going to, without actually pressing the shutter, smile, Phil. Thank you. And there's Phil's beautiful smiling mug right there automatically. Now, so I can automatically take pictures, so there's automation built in image capture. And of course, for pictures just like this, we have the built-in delete button. You can delete it right there, right off the camera. It actually deletes it right off the camera. So that's image capture, an incredible system-wide architecture for importing and handling images and digital cameras. Phil?
Thanks for deleting me, Chris. So now we have something at the core of the system that's never been there on the Mac or on Windows before, which is a true system-wide architecture for image acquisition. As Chris showed you, you can set, for example, your color sync profile, and that's by device. So I can set a different profile for one camera than another camera, and it remembers that in its database. So when I plug in, for example, a Canon camera may have a different profile, it automatically adjusts that, and all the applications that use image capture will automatically get all that data. Very, very powerful Pro technology built under the hood of Mac OS X. Now, ColorSync. Now, ColorSync has become an integral part about so many of our professional customers' workflow. And ColorSync has been built into Mac OS X at its core foundation. It's not added on as it was in the past. It's built in. And we've worked very hard to make it fast and high quality. So the Apple CMM now supports the Velocity Engine for acceleration on every G4 chip. We've worked to make a very accurate RGB to CMYK conversions. And we made sure that was standard-based for RGB and CMYK profiles based on the latest ISO and ANSI specs. We've had a lot of feedback to make this very accurate and standards-based. But probably the most fun thing about ColorSync, if it's somebody who works with it every day, is to go into the application folder and go into the utility directory and find the ColorSync utility. This is a powerful new version of the ColorSync utility. Allows you to get at and set your profiles. And it actually shows you your ColorSync profiles real-time rendered in 3D color space so you can rotate it around and take a look at the different ColorSync profiles you're working with and dive into all the data. So if you haven't used it yet, go inside the ColorSync utility and take a look at it. Our engineers have worked very hard to make this the best color management utility on any platform. So ColorSync is just built in. It's part of Mac OS X. Everything you see in the display is automatically managed without the user having to do anything with ColorSync. Probably the most powerful technology used by our pro customers is AppleScript. We had a lot of questions before 10 came out. What's Apple's commitment to AppleScript? We rely on it in our businesses. What are you doing to move it ahead? Well, we've done so much in Mac OS X to make AppleScript better than it ever was in 9 or 8. In fact, just in the Jaguar version, we've added some new capabilities, like folder actions, that now automatically work drag and drop anywhere on your desktop without even having to open the folders. Just drag documents to them, and the scripts automatically launch and start their process. We've got an integrating scripting menu, so that you can just drag scripts into a menu bar on the top, and now users can get at scripts instantly right from the menu bar, including all the great scripts that we provide. And we've now expanded the capabilities to script media types as well. You saw iPhoto, that's now scriptable. iDVD, scriptable, and so many other applications, in addition to all the applications you're used to, in addition to Photoshop and InDesign and all the other applications that are scriptable, we have these new media types too. And enhanced web services, that was something new in 10. With 10, we added the capability to get information over the web inside your Apple scripts using XML and SOAP, and we've enhanced those even further now with Jaguar. And in Jaguar, AppleScript now doesn't have to script the Finder to do file actions. Itself can actually do file actions without having to go through the Finder, making it more efficient and easier to program. Now, speaking of programming, if you've used AppleScript before and you've used it on 8 or 9, you probably used the little script editor application. And that's still there in 10. And as you know, it's a very simple, bare-bones text editor. What we heard very loud and clear from our AppleScript customers is they wanted a pure programming environment, something for professionals, for Apple scripts, because they've become so important to the workflow. They wanted something they could debug their scripts, and they can create user interfaces for their applications. Well, we gave them that. If you haven't used it yet, this is an amazingly powerful tool called the AppleScript Studio. And inside the AppleScript Studio, you use the same development tools that our Cocoa developers creating next-generation applications use. It uses the Interface Builder and Program Builder, Project Manager. You have all these tools and performance tools and debugging tools to create professional scripts. So you can still start with that simple script editor. Then you can move into the AppleScript Studio and build complete applications with user interfaces that not only control the local applications on your machine, but can create workflows across your network and across the internet. Amazingly powerful technology. So Chris, let's take a look at AppleScript.
Thanks, Phil. So, AppleScript is an amazingly powerful yet easy-to-use scripting language that's built into Mac OS X. It really makes automating workflows much easier by tying together using a scripting language all the applications that you need to actually create your output. You know that more than 80% of our top-tier publishing customers use AppleScript every day to automate their very, very sophisticated workflows. I'm sure you all are very familiar with AppleScript. I'm actually going to show you something maybe that you haven't thought of using AppleScript before. Just like I was able to create a nice linen-bound book of my portfolio to send to my clients, wouldn't it be great if I could have a living, breathing portfolio that I could send to people on DVD? And wouldn't it be great if I could use iPhoto and Photoshop and iDVD together to automate this when I bring in, when I've got new photos that I've just downloaded from my camera and I want to add those to my new portfolio? So this is exactly what I have here. I have a number of pictures here in my race photos library. Let me make that smaller so you can see them all. And what I've done ahead of time is I have this living, breathing portfolio template. As you can see right here on my desktop, it says DVD template on it. And I've predefined what this portfolio is, and it's already got some images embedded in it. And what I want to do is I want to add some new images to this portfolio so that I can create a new DVD that I'm going to send to my customers. So it's as simple as drag and drop. I'm going to highlight the pictures that I want to add. And through the magic of folder actions, as still described, I'm going to drag and drop them right here on the template folder. And with folder actions, it automatically kicks in. It asks me, what do I want to name this new slideshow that I'm going to add to my portfolio? And I'm going to call it race, because these are some nice road race features. And it's done. It's added those new pictures to my template. Now what I want to do is I hide iPhoto. Now that I've got my template set up just like I wanted and I've been able to add my new photos to my portfolio, I'm going to drag this folder right down here under the dock, right onto my AppleScript. And AppleScript's going to kick in. It's going to launch iDVD, and it's going to start laying out my special DVD. And the great thing about DVD, of course, is that I can configure it to look just like I want it. I can put my own special background on there with my logos. I can put music on there if I want to. AppleScript is now taking each image that I've put in that folder, and it's actually going to do a Photoshop process on each one. It's adding a color adjustment. It's going to resize each one to fit the TV better. Of course, the resolution is 640 by 480. So each of these pictures is going to be resized down to 640 by 480. And then it's going to add each of them into my DVD project. And this is great, the power of AppleScript, bringing iPhoto, iDVD, and Photoshop together to produce this. So here's our last photo. It's going to resize it and add our neutral background. And we're done. And of course, I could go ahead and preview this in iDVD if I wanted to, but I've already burnt this. Of course, I would go ahead at that point and simply burn my project. I've actually got a DVD preloaded in my tray, and I'm just going to bring that in there. Great thing about DVD, of course, you can customize the experience by providing a custom slideshow with your logo and your information on it set out just like you want. Of course, DVDs play on every standard consumer DVD player, so your customer can simply take that DVD and put it in their home consumer player. And they're also very high volume. DVDs hold more than 4.5 gigabytes of information. So rather than putting stuff on a CD, I can simply put it all in a DVD. So my DVD is loaded, and up comes my DVD player. And here's my finished DVD, and I can navigate through here just like any other DVD. I'm going to go into my race photos, and I can take a look at each one. And there they are. That's great. I can just pop this in a consumer DVD player. The other great thing about iDVD, iDVD 2.1, is rather than just get access to these pictures through the DVD player, I can actually go into the Finder and get access to the high-resolution versions of each of these. Let me blow these up nice and big so you can see them. These pictures are actually on the DVD itself, and your client can not only see them on their DVD player, but they can also go into the Finder and get access to them. And here's that same picture that we added as our last picture right there, open in preview. So that's the great integration that AppleScript gives you, being able to automate your workflows, in this case, bringing iDVD, iPhoto, and Photoshop together to create this really great portfolio that I can send to customers and clients on DVD.
Thanks, Chris. I think that demo is important for two reasons. Number one, all of us, somewhere or another in our workflow, has been starting to use AppleScript. In fact, about 80% of our largest publishing customers have automated parts of the workflow with AppleScript now. So you've seen us demonstrate automating color sync profiling with AppleScript and page layouts and putting things on servers and printing them. We wanted to show you not only is AppleScript alive and well and doing even better under 10, and some of the new features in Jaguar, but at the same time, we also wanted to show you this important new medium. I'm running into so many of our design customers who are now using DVDs as a way to share some of their work, to send out portfolios, to send out content for review, and as Chris showed you, not only can you create a standard DVD in a few simple steps, that you can then pop into a DVD player, but the actual high-res content can be put on that 4.6 gigabyte DVD as well. And it's one of the easiest way to send around that content and let people have access to it if that's what you want. So that's iDVD working and being Apple scripted. Well, next up, I promise we'll talk about fonts. And Apple, certainly working with Adobe and other vendors, has really made modern typography and fonts on computers something that's so enjoyable to use and a part of our workflow. And with Mac OS X and Jaguar in particular, we've really enhanced the state of the art of font technology, as well as the text engine that renders all that on screen. And inside Mac OS X Jaguar, we now have built-in rasterizers for TrueType and PostScript and the new OpenType formats, as well as support for multiple masters. So when you create a multiple master implementation, you can just view that and use that within your documents and on Mac OS X. And there are so many great new fonts included in Mac OS X. There's really over $10,000 worth of fonts, not only for the U.S. market, but internationally, where places like Japan and China, it costs so much. It's not like the U.S. market. And there it costs so much to buy high-quality fonts that work at any resolution and you're licensed to use in your printer. And that's something we worked very hard to include with Mac OS X and Jaguar. And in terms of usability, one feature that has been highly requested by customers is the ability to organize your fonts in your folders. As you may know, there are two places you can put fonts on Mac OS X. There's a system-wide library for fonts that affect everybody who uses that system. There's also a user library. You can set up your own font library for whoever logs onto the computer under 10. So you have two places. And within those font folders, you can now place subfolders. So, for example, I can create a folder of fonts I'm going to use just for a job and just drag that folder into the font folder, and I'll now have a hierarchical system for my fonts. If I ever want to remove them later, just drag them out. So you can dynamically work with hierarchies. We also have on-screen rendering of anti-aliasing, and you have the ability to now tune that with four different on-screen smoothing technologies. For example, whether you're looking on a CRT or on a TFT, there's different smoothing technologies that make it look just right for your display. And our text technology is now based on the latest version of Unicode, Unicode 3.2. It adds support for additional languages, language you probably never thought you'd see in a computer, support for glyphs for things like Yi or Hawaiian, which is a lot of fun. We've had some surprised customers actually in Hawaii sending us emails saying, wow, you now have all the glyphs fully supported. We didn't even expect that. In fact, a font based with this new version of Unicode can now have over 32,000 glyphs in a font face. That's incredible, the rapid expansion of glyphs for languages like Japanese and Chinese that really take advantage of that. We're the only ones not only using and delivering that, but delivering fonts with that many glyphs. And the tools we use to interface with this every day, the font panel has been updated with some new features, for example, for rapid display of the font types you're selecting. And there's a great new tool called the Character Palette. Now, I think some of you may know the keycaps that back in 7, 8, and 9 we got to know and use every day as the way to find that special character that you want to use all the time. Well, if keycaps was the infant, the Character Palette's like Schwarzenegger. Right? So it is keycaps grown up, beefed up, and become something incredibly powerful in a Unicode world. Now, here's a screenshot of the new font panel, which now has the ability to display the font as you're selecting them at various sizes, and behind it, the new character palette that unlocks the power of all those Unicode glyphs. So Chris, if you could demonstrate some of the new type features.
Absolutely. So I heard a big round of applause earlier for font, so I expect nonetheless more of that. Okay. So let me show you, first of all the great fonts that are built in. I'm going to open my preview application. I've got a PDF, actually, that displays all these. You'll notice a new feature of our preview application, the thumbnail drawer. I can actually go through and look at each page in my PDF right there. I'm actually going to close that. Make this a little bit bigger so you can see it. We have got an amazing set of fonts built into Mac OS X. Let's start off with some of the Roman ones. Amazing set of fonts. Lots of ligatures built into each one. A beautiful new font face that we're now including in Jaguar called Koshan, which is a great sans serif font face. It's great for book layout. Copper plate, all-time favorite. Futura, which is an amazingly modern, nice font. I think probably one of the most interesting Euro symbols you're going to see around. Scroll down here for a few more of them. The standard Helvetica. Herculaneum, another very popular one. Lucida Grande, which is our system font. My favorite of all time is Optima. Very elegant, very clean. And of course, I think probably one of the really coolest fonts is Zapfino. You'll notice, because of the built-in text engine in Mac OS X, the ability here, Zapfino in the swash of the F actually dips down to the line below. That's all made possible by Mac OS X's text engine. So that's some of the Roman fonts that are built in. And lots of these fonts support lots of different languages, of course, that are all Roman character-based. But what about other languages? What about non-Roman languages? We've added a lot of support in Mac OS X for new languages. Let's start off with Arabic languages. We have five fonts for Arabic, and we also have three fonts for Hebrew. I think one of the most interesting things is these languages, when you input them, of course, they're right-to-left languages rather than what we know as left-to-right. And that text input is all supported as well in Mac OS X. And also made possible by our Unicode support. We have an amazing set of Chinese fonts. Phil mentioned earlier there are more than 32,000 glyphs in these Chinese character sets. Mac OS X includes fonts that meet the GB18030 specification for Chinese fonts. And we have a number of great faces that provide both simplified and traditional Chinese faces. We also have an incredible set of Japanese fonts, as Phil mentioned, more than 20,000 glyphs in each of our Japanese characters in four beautiful hiragino faces. We have support for Thai. There are three separate fonts for Thai. And Korean as well. By the way, that's the symbol for hot spring right there, if you're wondering. We have support also for Indic languages. The Devanagari script actually supports the Sanskrit-based languages, which includes Hindi. Gujarati supports Punjab, the Punjab language, and Gurmukhi supports the Gurmukhi language. So there are a number of languages supported with three different script inputs in Mac OS X and three different fonts as well. And last but not least, of course, is our Cyrillic characters for Russian and Eastern European languages, and we have five fonts for those. So an amazing set of fonts built into Mac OS X. The great thing also about our font system is you can add your own fonts, of course. You can also add new keyboard layouts, and you can just drag and drop those right into Mac OS X and add more functionality yourself. So those are the great fonts built into Mac OS X. Yay, come on. So let's take a quick tour of our font panel. As you know, the font panels is a really great, useful tool for getting at all the fonts in the system. Very scalable. It can shrink down as small as I want it with nice pop-up menus. I can stretch it out. I can make it much bigger to see all the collections and families. We've added some new features here, the ability to actually add a slider for scrolling the size of a particular face. We've also added the ability to preview. Let me change my... I like Lucida as a great preview font. To actually preview the font face right there, right in the font panel, so you can see. And you, of course, can select the different sizes, and it'll preview those particular sizes. That's a great new feature. I mentioned earlier some of the great type features in Mac OS X, and I'm going to show you one of them right now. This is the Zapfino font, which I mentioned. And you'll notice that as I type this font, that Mac OS X is smart enough to automatically insert the correct ligature here as I go from the P to the F. You can see that the P changes and the F, and actually inserts a special ligature to connect those two characters together, and it does that automatically. Even cooler, the entire word Zapfino is a ligature in and of itself. And when I finish typing it, the Mac OS X text system goes in and replaces the whole word with the proper ligature. That's very cool. Of course, we have kerning built in for controlling the spacing between letters, baseline support for height and vertical. So lots of great, wonderful features there for text layout. Let me go back to Lucida here. Now, Phil mentioned the character palette. So let me bring that open here. This really is the Schwarzenegger, if you will, of keycaps, like he said. This lets you get at all the different characters that are in every single font that we have in the system. And because we're Unicode-based, we've got this incredible tool to really tweeze out all those characters that you've always wondered how to get to. You always had to kind of remember, you know, what key combination got me that character, or what numbers do I have to type to get that character. Well, with the character palette, we can have a nice UI that gives you access to all the faces and all the characters and all the fonts in the system. This is the standard Roman interface. This is some of the more frequently used Roman characters you're going to see. I'm just going to come over here and double-click one of these. So I get a plus, I get a minus, some standard math operators. Accent and Latin characters, probably one of the hardest for people to, you know, where is that special slash O or O slash character? And there it is, and I can just grab it right here in the UI character palette. On top of our incredible Japanese input methods, we also have the ability to get at all the Japanese fonts through the character palette. I can sort and look through these by radical. A lot of times, you want to find a character by the kind of strokes that make up that particular character, and that's what this does. It categorizes each character, all 20,000 glyphs in our Japanese font set, and it characterizes them by the different base strokes. And I can go through all 200-plus categories of base strokes and access the different characters in each set. But I think one of the most interesting things here is this last panel, the all panel. If you're a Unicode jock and you know everything there is to know about Unicode, you know that Unicode is made up of all these different blocks of particular kind of characters. And of course, now in the character palette, I can get at each of these blocks, basic Latin characters are here. So any currency symbols, for example, I can get at the different currency symbols. So all the Unicode blocks are actually represented in the character palette. But perhaps one of the most interesting things is the glyph catalog. Let me go back to my Lucida font. Lucida is actually a very broad font. Supports many of the different languages in Mac OS X, has a lot of different characters in it. I can get at all the different characters right here, and looking in the Lucida face, the R with the double grav on it. Every esoteric character you always have been looking for, you can get directly from the character palette. So an amazing new way of getting at all the font faces and all the new characteristics that are embedded in the text system, all made possible by Mac OS X's built-in support for Unicode in this amazing set of fonts that we have. Bill?
Thanks, Chris. The font and text rendering capabilities inside Mac OS X are simply astounding. The team has worked to create really the state-of-the-art text rendering engine and font technology, and I think you've seen just a glimpse of what you can get at. I think the Zapfino font, for me, illustrates that just the best. It's a built-in support for all those glyphs and for the kerning and the ligatures. It's just remarkable, and every font can be that powerful. Next up, Rendezvous. Rendezvous is a technology you may have just recently heard about. It's come out here with Jaguar, and Rendezvous is our answer to an age-old problem of how do I configure devices? What a pain in the neck trying to figure out how on networks to configure devices. And not just computer to computer, though it does that, but also computer to other devices and device to device, because it's open standard. We have now provided the world, working with the IETF, an open standards model for connecting devices. And it allows us to automatically discover other devices over an IP network, with no configuration required by the user. Wouldn't that be nice? I mean, how often do we have to configure our network devices? And what's a kind of device that we have to configure over the network all the time in our print and publishing world? Printers. Printers have to be configured over a network, and it eats up so much time and effort to do this well. Well, at Macworld, we announced Rendezvous with support from some of the largest printer makers, from Epson and HP and Lexmark. And then here today, you'll hear new announcements from companies like Xerox, who now be supporting the Rendezvous discovery model. And Canon, with their professional image prograph printers, now supporting Rendezvous. So Rendezvous is going to become this incredible technology that's making it easier every day. We already use it in Mac OS X Jaguar in many ways, like our iChat application, and more you're going to see devices like printers, but as well as companies like Philips doing with TVs and many others, even in software companies. Sybase has announced database support to automatically configure database clients over a network without the previous confusing array of IP setup and configuration. Very powerful technology, and in a minute in the printing section, we'll show you what that looks like. So that's Rendezvous. It's going to become part of one more way that we've helped using standards to make our life easier in a professional work environment. I want to end the technology part of this with printing, something we all live with every day, work, and we remember the days when Mac OS really brought a breakthrough in making printing powerful and yet easy to use. And we're doing that again with Mac OS X. So with Mac OS X, we've added new technology under the hood for printer sharing, something that was very highly requested from our education customers. We've got a single application now for managing your printers called the Print Center. It's been completely rewritten in Jaguar and Cocoa to be fast and feature-rich. And two features that we've had tremendous requests from our professional publishing customers is, number one, having multiple save settings. I want to set up different printers in a specific way, and I don't want to have to go back and do it again. And you can now do that with Jaguar. And I want to have support for custom paper sizes. I have logical paper sizes, and I can choose those and save those and use those in all my applications, and that's built in. But the real major breakthrough, and probably the single biggest new piece of technology in Jaguar, is the new printing engine itself, under the hood. Most users never have to see it, but pros can get under there and take advantage of it, and that's the new printing architecture. And it's based on something from the Unix world called CUPS,
the Common Unix Printing System, version 1.1. And it's true Unix-based client-server spoofing built into Mac OS X, under the hood. So somebody who was using 10.1 upgrades to 10.2, prints, they don't know anything changed under the hood. But we all know under the hood is a much more powerful engine that's now driving printing. It's based on the Internet Printing Protocol, and of course it uses Adobe PPDs to describe the printers, and it gives powerful new management software and technologies for managing printers, for managing users, for managing jobs. And probably one of the most incredible things about it is that it's open source underneath the hood, so it's very extendable. You're going to hear some things about that in a minute. So you can get through all this in the Print Center and just manage your printers as you did before, but pro users are going to want to get at that CUPS printing engine, and you get at it in a very interesting way. Anyone's ever used a Unix system, you know. You actually get through your browser. There's actually HTML code that runs the CUPS printing engine underneath the hood of Mac OS X. So perhaps you're one of our customers who already upgraded to Jaguar, and you've been printing away, and you didn't know, wait a minute, I can open my browser. You go to port 631 on your computer, and now I'm getting at the printing engine in Unix under the hood with a lot more capabilities than is exposed through the Print Center. Well, I'd like to bring up John Zimmerer, our Color and Imaging Product Marketing Manager, to demonstrate the new printing technologies in Mac OS X. John?
Thanks, Phil. Good morning, everybody. It's great to be back here at Siebel, see some familiar faces. We'll catch up later. Right now, I've got to go through some printing features. There's a lot of new stuff in Mac OS 10.2 Jaguar, and we're only really going to scratch the surface of it this morning. First, I want to visit some of the features that are straight from your to-do list. These are things that creative professionals using Mac OS X said, please add this when you do your next version, and we said, okay. So the first thing is under page setup, under settings, you see that we have support for custom paper size. Now, custom paper size actually enables several different things, one of which is called borderless printing, also called edge-to-edge or full bleed printing. And you may have noticed over the past week or week and a half, some of our partners like HP and Canon have released new drivers for Jaguar, and those drivers now support the full bleed edge-to-edge printing. Another thing that we get is the ability to print to large format devices like the one that we have here on stage. And here we have a couple of custom paper sizes pre-configured. Any combination of dimensions for height and width, and any combination of margin settings. Anything that you need in your day-to-day workflow. We even have one here configured for 5 feet wide by 100 feet long. So any type of job that you print, you can set up a custom paper size for. Now, it's important to note that in Jaguar, these are logical pages, not physical pages. These aren't tied to any particular device. So regardless of which application you're in, you're able to access the same set of custom paper sizes and then choose the device at print time. Speaking of print time, you print day in, day out, multiple jobs, but most of those jobs fall into a few categories. And every time you print, you don't want to have to go into the print dialogs and check that setting and pull down that menu and have to remember what's the combination to get this proof out. So another thing from your to-do list is multiple save settings. And those are grouped under the presets pop-up. We have a few here. Any type of printing that you do, any combination of settings, you can group together in a single pop-up. We have a few here for calibrating and profiling our device. You could be having different settings for proofing, printing final product. Whatever you need to accomplish, you can roll them all together in Jaguar in the printing system. Now, Phil mentioned that we've also updated and expanded Print Center. Print Center is the application that you use to add printers, queues, and to manage jobs. It's sort of your window into the printing system. Now, you'll notice here that these printers, these queues are showing up and they have a background. And that background is to identify these as shared queues. These are not local queues. I'm actually pulling these queues from our server that we have on the edge of the stage. And this is actually a feature delivered by CUPS. Now, printer sharing in Mac OS X is very different from printer sharing that you may be used to. It's not limited to just USB raster devices. Any queue that you create on Jaguar, you can share. So that could be a USB raster, it could be a USB PostScript, it could be a FireWire printer, it could even be an AppleTalk queue that I have locally that I want to share across my LAN or to somebody else on a remote network through the internet. Now, CUPS, Common Unix Printing System. PrintCenter is only one mirror, one window into the printing system. We have others. The most common way to get into CUPS from other Unix distributions is through the web interface. Now, Phil mentioned earlier that your IP address, :631, which is the port that CUPS publishes the web pages on, will take you straight to your machine's CUPS interface. Now, many of the same things that you can do in PrintCenter, you can also do in the CUPS web interface, including managing printers and managing jobs. But CUPS is extremely full-featured. It is a professional, scalable, client-server spooling architecture, and it allows you to do some interesting things like create printer classes. Maybe you have four or five of the same device that you use for printing or proofing. You can collect all of those devices into a class and publish one queue that your users see, and CUPS behind the scenes meters those print jobs out to whichever printer happens to be available at that time. So this is my local queue. CUPS is also part of our server product, so depending on if you're on the desktop or on the server, you have the same access to CUPS. And speaking of access, CUPS gives us a window to a whole new world. Because CUPS was born in the Unix community, CUPS is actually open source. And it gives us entry into a whole new world of open source software. Now, I have here an Epson printer that we do not, in Jaguar, ship a driver from Epson 4. We have hundreds of drivers in macOS 10 Jaguar supporting hundreds of printers, both raster and PostScript. But this particular device, there is no driver installed. So you see here, go to USB, it knows that there is a printer attached, but it also knows that there is no driver installed. Available today, through many sources, but available today through the macOS 10 downloads page, you can download GIMP Print. GIMP Print is a collection of open source drivers supporting hundreds of additional printers above and beyond what we've poured into Jaguar from the vendors. Downloading GIMP Print is a simple process. It's a macOS 10 disk image. It uses the macOS 10 installer. A couple of clicks and you have new drivers installed. So if I go to the advanced and tell it, hey, there's a 1200 there, it immediately fills in the device name and the location of the device. All I need to do is pick a PPD for this device. There are dozens of PPDs for this for the Epson model supplied in the GIMP Print package. I pick the 1200's PPD, I add it, and now I can print to a device that I wasn't able to print to before. Now, that's only one part of the story. There's a lot of open source software out there, including an open source PostScript interpreter called GhostScript. GhostScript is also available from many sources. Again, today you can download it from the macOS 10 downloads page. Once you install the GhostScript interpreter, combined with the CUPS driver I have here, not only can I print to this device, I can print PostScript to this device. So let me show you how easy that is. Double-click the queue, open the queue, drag and drop a PostScript job, and immediately the printer kicks into action. That is one of the powerful benefits that CUPS brings to the table. Now, I think that the last thing that we want to talk to you a little bit about today here is Rendezvous. Now, Rendezvous, all the talk that we've done so far about Rendezvous has really been around printers. Rendezvous makes a really hard task extremely simple. I want to be able to find that device using IP, but I don't want to have to know the device's IP address. I don't want to have to worry about subnets. I don't want to have to worry about what I call it. I just want to go to it. It's as easy as clicking Add. You notice that the Directory Services has Rendezvous support. This particular device is publishing three different queues using three different protocols. As soon as I click on the IPP queue, we automatically know that this is an HP DesignJet 5500, brand new, shipping at the show, or announced at the show. I click Add, and I immediately have access to this printer. I didn't have to know anything about its address, didn't have to know where it was, what it's called, anything. And now I can print to the device. But printer discovery is only one part of the story. Rendezvous is about service discovery. And a device can actually be advertising multiple services, and this device is. One of the services that it's advertising is the fact that it has a built-in web server. So if I want to know what is the status of a job, how much media do I have, how much ink have I consumed, all I need to do is hit this server's web page. But what's the address? I don't know, and I don't have to know. All I have to do is click on the queue in Print Center and click the configure button. When we register the printer, we register the web server, and immediately we can be taken to this printer's web server. This is just scratching the surface of what CUPS in the open source community brings. This is scratching the surface of printing in Jaguar. I invite you to come by the booth and see all the hard work that we've poured into the Jaguar products. Thank you very much. Phil?
Thank you, John. I think what you've seen with Jaguar, with this entirely new print system under the hood, we've been able to retain the map ease of use for printing that we're so well known for, but also adding to our capabilities that make it even easier, that capability of rendezvous. Yet under the hood, we've now been able to take the most powerful printing system. A lot of people hook Unix workstations to printing setups because of some of the capabilities and open source software up there, but we have that now too. So we have the Mac ease of use, we have the power of a Unix-based system all integrated to really give you entirely new printing environments. And this demo with that HP printer is just something remarkable. The fact that you can, with one click, configure a network printer, and Print Center knows that inside that printer is a server software that's advertising how to manage it and get you to it, is just something that's not capable before on any platform. Again, I want to reiterate what John said, that if you want to extend the CUPS printing engine, it's open source and you can. You can go to the macOS 10 downloads page today and get the GIMP print drivers to add more print drivers. We've made it really easy for you to do it, unlike on Unix systems. And you can download interpreters like that GhostScript interpreter today and add that to your system and make raster printers that weren't PostScript-based before now handle all your PostScript jobs. So very, very powerful new technology. And that rounds out the technologies I wanted to talk to you inside Jaguar today, things that we don't get to cover in a lot of other venues, Quartz Extreme and QuickTime and Inkwell and Image Capture and ColorSync and AppleScript, in particular, fonts and rendezvous and printing. And this joins the over 150 new features in Jaguar to make macOS 10 now far and away the best print publishing and design platform. And that's why it's really taking off so well and being received by some of our customers, as we've really thought about these creative markets and what they need out of a new generation macOS platform. I want to highlight one other thing that hasn't had a lot of attention yet, which is we, along with the client, have now released a brand new version of our server software as well. The new Jaguar version of macOS 10 server, and with it delivers, again, the power of this Unix base with Mac ease of use, and you can get at capabilities that were never possible before, and that will allow you to change the workflow inside your creative departments or small businesses. The ability to have very powerful Open Directory user group management, the ability to manage the workload on the services your server is running, and to serve up clients for Mac and Windows and Unix systems all from one product, and of course, it's the perfect complement to this brand new X server product that people are now starting to put in to power the back ends of their creative workflows. So again, that's Jaguar, and we're really proud to bring it out to our creative customers because of all this technology you see under the hood, and we're really, most importantly, proud of the things you all do with it. Things that we talked about at the talk, beginning of the talk, with things like the New Yorker, and all this incredible content that's made on a Mac. So I want to thank you very much for this chance to talk to you about Apple and the technologies building for you in the print publishing and design markets. Thank you.